are now tuned in to Beige Phillip. More importantly, bitches ain't shit.
Mandingo.
I've been reading bitches my whole life. That's my job. That's why.
If you haven't problems, this shit is real. Y'all think Nero knows what the fuck he is doing?
There's no real girl code. It's just good. It's what I call bitch politics.
You know what women want most of all?
More.
More.
Exactly. Yeah. Whatever it is they want.
More. It's time to join the movement. GYBB. Get your balls back.
They don't understand. I'm giving you the best of me so that I can fuck them. But once that's over, the contract is over.
Right? Wrong. Everything your mama said. Wrong. Fuck that bitch too.
But this is some stuff I pulled out of the Bible. Now, I don't believe in the Bible. I don't.
And then the Lord said,
Timothy 2:11-15, let a woman learn quietly with all submissiveness. Shut your mouth!
Oh, shit. It's about to go down. GYBB, get your balls back. BABB, be a better bitch. WWDD, what would Dante do? And I am excited.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
I'm excited. Yeah.
Why so excited?
I don't know, because this one right here.
Uh-huh. What about this show?
This is a special show.
What?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, this one?
This one, it is special. And I'll tell you, I've said that 180 times before. Mm-hmm. But this time I mean it.
Oh, good.
Because when you get down to it, they're all special shows, if you know what I mean. Mara, how are you today?
You know, I'm a little sick, but we're here.
You're here?
I'm still excited.
You look a little, you're excited and sick.
Yeah.
Well, you know, they say laughter is the best cure for HPV. I don't know if you heard that.
I don't know how I have it then. I don't.
You ready for this?
Yes, I'm ready.
I know you're a little down in the weather, but I appreciate you coming out. I'm tired of these motherfuckers asking me where the fuck you are every time you go to work.
Sorry, I gotta. It's hard here.
I told them to tweet you and go, yo, come home, bitch. Did they tweet you?
Like, bring the crabs with you. Go to work. I'm like,
go to work. That's a little lice amongst friends, right? Shit. I don't know. Harry, what's going on with you? You good?
I'm good, man. Good.
Yeah?
Yeah. I mean, I got a headache a little bit, but that's all right. I powered through it. I don't need to complain.
You got a headache?
You know what? From
Why?
Keeping these gators down.
It is difficult.
Stressful.
Pimping ain't easy, but
it
gets easier if you practice. That's what I heard.
That's true.
My little retarded son, how are you?
Man,
you good?
You
got pulled over in a cab. You know the only nigga I know that gets pulled over in a cab.
It don't make no sense. In a cab? I get pulled over?
You got profiled in a cab.
Shouldn't resist.
I think
because
the dude was African.
Shouldn't resist.
If we had an Indian cab driver, I would have been here.
Well, maybe Russian.
If Russian,
he wouldn't have pulled you over.
But
what this problem off is so.
I don't know why you have to pull me over. I am trying to make a living.
It was funny. Nigga said, he said, me?
Who, me?
The cop knocked. He said, me? Yes, nigga, you the only one dropping. Fuck, you think it's me, stupid?
Oh, my God. So, let me just get down to who we got here today. First of all, I'm going to introduce, we have a Beige Phillip advocate and fan, met him a couple of days ago, just an advocate practicing Beige Phillip disciple.
Working.
Just met him at the comedy club, we kicked it, and he's doing the work, putting in the work. Give it up for Danny, y'all. Yep. Give it up for Danny.
Thank you.
You gotta speak up, Danny. Speak up, Danny.
It's good to be here.
Yeah, good to have you. And Danny and I, we spoke a little bit. We talked on the phone a bit, and Danny did a hot seat. What do you call it? Hot seat?
A seminar.
With a pretty famous pickup artist, pickup artist. Is that okay? Can I use that terminology?
For now, yeah.
All right. Why is that? Because I know some guys don't want to be called that, so.
Well, the thing is, it's like, you know, you have all these prejudices about what is a pickup artist, what is a life coach. Everyone has, like, an image of that. But I think your audience probably, like, you know.
All right. Fair enough. Give it up for Valentino Cohen. Give it up for Valentino, y'all. Thanks for coming out, brother. This is going to be interesting because, I'm a clear advocate. I get what you're saying about that whole thing about
just what is a pickup artist. I think there's a lot of guys out there who are doing...
Like the negative connotations.
Yeah, the negative connotations. Yeah. A lot of guys that are just taking people's money, which is a fucked up situation because you're in... it's almost like molesting children.
it's really bad, actually. Like, we were at Union Square the other day, and you just see, like, people, like, running around like headless chicken after chicks.
Was it other pickup artists?
Yeah, or whatever. I wouldn't even call them that. But the thing is, like, it's like molesting people. It's like, you know, getting in their space, demanding that everyone has to stop, look at them. It's just not normal.
Wait,
you know,
so
I would rather say if you, like, well, call me, like, a dating coach, because for me...
Okay.
If you look at it like, oh, I just want to pick up the chick.
Right, right.
It's more about, oh, I just want to get her. I just want to get her number. It doesn't actually matter how I feel. It doesn't matter how she feels. It doesn't matter what happens afterwards. And once I had sex, it's over.
Sure.
And that's really, if you go deep and if you have trained and taught thousands of students,
right.
That doesn't make you happy.
Right.
In the end.
In the end, it doesn't.
Yeah, in the end, you want to, it's like a false kind of like belief that you think, well, once I get that,
right.
I'll be happy. Same with like, once I get money, then I'll be happy. Thing with money, for example, it's just like an amplifier. If you're a dick, it's going to be a
You'll
big
be
dick.
A bigger dick. Okay.
And if you're a nice person, you're going to be a much nicer person.
So when I get rich, I'm going to be amazingly awesome as opposed to being.
Exactly.
Wow. Jesus, I don't know if that can happen, Mara. I don't know.
We're going to see.
We are going to see. Because
we'll
it's coming.
Be a witness.
I'm about to blow the fuck up. So,
what am I going to be then?
Oh, my God.
A bigger cunt?
A huge gelatinous cunt.
I might get involved in this.
with like,
yeah, Andre's
like,
oh no,
like I can see it coming. More retarded, not possible. Okay, don't get money and get stupid.
Full on retard.
Good. Glad to be here.
I got picked up the other day.
Oh shit! What happened?
Yeah, what happened?
It was total. Like
this
he totally
dude just picked
scammed
you up
me.
And just picked you
he
up.
Totally. I was at Adidas getting a jersey for the boyfriend because we've made it a year.
Oh shit!
Damn.
Listen, let's say a moment of silence.
I know. And I was like, "Do you have a David Villa jersey?"
Yeah, I know.
And
what
the
that
guy,
is.
It's a soccer player.
Well, it's David Villa.
And, it's yeah. David. It's David.
Okay, easy, yeah. Bitch. What
the fuck? That's Terry.
One line. What the
Terry.
She was like, Davi. Which is all in the
I'm
soccer
just letting
now.
You know.
I've been to two games. Okay.
Yeah. She's a real fucking fan of Le Football.
And football.
And then the guy goes, we don't have it. I'll get you a discount on this one, just the regular inaugural season one. And I was like, okay, cool. So how do we do that? And he goes, put your name and number in here. And I was like, okay. And then at the end, I was like, okay, so now what? Does it text to my phone? He goes, no, we'll hang out after. I'll bring it. And I was like, oh.
You got me. Now I'm not going to answer your fucking phone call, you stupid, because
so
all I wanted was a shirt.
Yeah, that is scary.
Imagine you actually wouldn't have a boyfriend. How would you feel if that would happen? Like,
I'd probably like totally stammer on. I'd be like, "Oh my god, I didn't like because I'm not good at lying."
Because the guy's like, "Oh, look, I want to." He puts like too many expectations on the whole thing already, right? You don't even know him.
I don't know him at all.
Let me tell you something. Valentino is going technical right now, so let me buckle up because I guess I'm gonna have to go in.
Valentino,
sorry, I'm not gonna take over. You guys,
no. I mean, it's really about you. But here's what's interesting is the fact that. Just making that observation gives you a certain level of authenticity, in my mind anyway, because of the fact that you're saying, okay, you're looking at this engagement and saying, okay, what's wrong with this? Okay, which is...
Yeah, you can tell, like, it's literally like you look at a guy, how he's doing it, and you can just feel, okay, well, that's okay. He's not too crazy about, you know, running after girls, or he doesn't, like, put too much pressure on them, but maybe... He doesn't make it interesting at all. And he just shows, look, let's do this. And the girl's like, why did you already decide? I don't even know who you are.
Right.
Why do you want to be with me just because of my looks, for example, or just because of the way I walk? Like, you don't even know who I am. So your standards are so low.
One of the things
you can see, like, this is the one little thing you have to work on.
Right.
And there the biggest problem is, first of all, she's already taken.
Right.
And the other problem is that why would he already commit that much? He doesn't even know her.
Okay, well, I guess what you're saying is something that we say on the show all the time. It's like if you're rewarding a woman for doing nothing, then she doesn't cherish. No, and no human being appreciates something when they get it for nothing. We always appreciate something that we've earned, that we've taken time and effort to put into it. It's just we cherish it more. And the analogy I use, if you give a kid, 18-year-old kid, you give him a Porsche, chances are he's going to wrap it around a tree in the course of a month or two, because it doesn't mean anything.
Exactly.
And I always talk about a shit bucket Chevette, a puke green Chevette with vinyl bait, and I used to shine the rust off of it, and I just, it was my, but it was my car,
yeah.
And I earned it, I worked for it, and I made it, and so the same thing happens, I think, when women think that you're giving them attention for nothing, and they're so accustomed to getting attention for not being attractive in the first place, so it's kind of a thing like, okay, whatever, what's different about
yes,
you?
Yes.
So
yes.
So I mean, so I was teasing you, but I gotta respect the fact that it you're already looking at this. You're looking at the infield tapes already and going, okay, this is why this doesn't work. Why this is buyer's remorse. So exactly. She gives the number and
exactly.
Then she goes,
exactly.
Wouldn't have gave you the number under these pretenses.
But it's like you also don't want to be like, well, I'm just gonna give you attention when you earn it.
Mm.
For me, it's more like we could do it, but I don't know if we will.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right,
like,
right.
I feel like a girl is something that you want to appreciate. Just
sure.
For what she is. But you don't need it. If at one point she doesn't want to do it, it's like, okay, cool.
Right.
I don't need you.
Right.
So I wouldn't be like, well, I only give you my attention, or you have to earn it, or you have to chase me. It always comes from like this, like kind of like position where you're like, I don't know if I'm enough. I don't know if I am good enough to just stay there. Show my intentions, and if she wants to like go along, yeah, then we can do
it. Is it that you don't know if you want her to feel, if you don't know if she's enough, or you don't know if you're enough?
Well, both.
Wow, that's interesting. Why do you think that that's necessary? Because I don't advocate that at all. I know I'm enough.
I'm saying that it kind of like comes across that somebody might feel, look, I'm not enough. That's why.
Are you talking about in this particular case?
No, more like general, like what he was saying.
Now, when you're saying I'm not enough, you mean you're not enough, or she's not enough, or both of you are not enough, or what?
I'm saying that that's like the biggest problem most people have. It's not only with dating, just with anything. If you're not doing something, you're afraid that you're not enough to do it. If you want to be the best soccer player, but you're not going for it, it's because you feel you're not enough. If you want to be a musician, but you're not going for it, it's because you feel you're not enough. You think all the other people are much, much better. So once you have that feel, look, I'm good enough. My value as a human being is exactly the same as everybody else.
I see what you're saying.
Why would I need to have the girl do something special so that she gets my attention?
Hmm.
You know what I mean?
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
It's more of a proactive kind of position where you just go for what you want, and if somebody wants to come along, that's fine. But if they don't want to, you don't need them.
Yeah, I think we're saying that we're saying the same thing. Here's, I think, where the difference is. I think that you're right. I think that you have to understand, and one of the things that I advocate is to always be the best version of yourself. Always be working to be the best version of yourself. If you're not doing that, then there's no confidence. You're not gonna have it. You're gonna be. You're already going to transmit insecurity because you really don't believe it.
Exactly.
And if you're lying about who you are, if you're really not doing the work, then you no matter how much you can fake it. I mean, one thing about women, they're very perceptive about very intuitive about those things, and they may not actually be able to put a name on it.
Uh-huh.
But they go, this is, something is wrong with
this. Yeah, exactly. It just doesn't
It's kind
feel
of an esoteric
right.
kind of just intuitive
like,
thing.
Good,
this guy
that's
not really,
good.
I don't know what it is, but I just don't like him.
Yeah. Right.
But I think you have to take into consideration, it's not just, I'm good enough, you need to work, because you still have to approach her. You still have to be the one that approaches, because women aren't built for that kind of rejection. They don't go through the rejection that we go through.
It's like, do you guys like Apple products? Do you like?
Yeah,
obviously.
Sure, sure.
We all have MacBooks.
Yeah, there's nothing here.
So,
but Apple products.
If you go to an Apple store,
yeah,
and you made a decision, look, I need a new MacBook.
Right.
So you go there, But then there's, you know, the new MacBook, like the basic MacBook thing. Right, then there's a MacBook Air. There's a MacBook Retina, the 13, 15-inch. You're like, I don't know which one I want.
Right.
But maybe, look, the 13-inch looks interesting enough. Let's have a look. Let's check it out. Let's try it out.
Right.
You haven't committed it. You haven't bought it yet. You haven't, like, gone for it yet. You're just trying it out. You just see how it works with you. Same if you see somebody who's attractive.
Sure.
And I encourage women to do the same thing. Like, if you see someone who actually comes across like someone you might want to get to know a little bit better, you should go up and approach. It's the same thing as if you go up and look at that computer, but you haven't committed yet.
Right.
It's not that you're like, I approach you and it's done.
Right.
Like, whatever happens.
So what you're saying is,
you know?
and that's
she has to still like meet your standards. But how can you find out if she actually can meet your standards?
Unless you engage. Right. So what you're saying is, look, I think you're attractive, but I don't know. I don't even know if I like you yet. I haven't even decided.
It's like you seem interesting enough,
right,
to start a conversation,
right, and that's enough. That's enough to start, and then we'll
see. But the girl has to, like, in a sense, like,
now,
win
I've
me over.
Too. I've said that to a girl. I don't even know if I like you. Like when a girl's like, oh, I just, yeah, I haven't even decided whether I like you. Calm the fuck down. You know what I mean? Because you get women, especially in the States, you know, women are very aggressive and they can be kind of, you know, they can be kind of condescending and stuff like
but
that.
But why? Why do you think that?
Why?
Mara, representative.
Mara, your fault.
Huh?
No, Mara,
explain,
like,
for America.
I think it's the best if she answered that question, right? Because she might be in that situation more than us.
Well, I actually know Mara better than she does. But
I know. All right. I don't know.
I think we're constantly catcalled and harassed
It's our fault.
So we're always on the defensive.
So whose fault is it, actually?
It's our fault.
It's the fault of the guys. Because they usually, like, most guys, they go up way too blunt. Their ego's their ego's going to be hurt if the girl says no. So they overdo it. They overcompensate. And if they don't get the reaction they want, they're like, well, fuck you then. You know?
Well,
and that makes
them
defensive.
So you need
to show, if you want to walk up, if you want to start talking to a girl, you need to, first of all, get through that initial, like, face with a girl, because how can a girl know who you are? Is she rejecting you? No, fuck no. She's rejecting the 5 seconds she saw from you.
Right.
And usually it's an automated response because it happens so often.
Well,
she doesn't want to think about it.
It's that she has to think about. I mean, one of the things that we say here initially is that a woman has to, she has to make sure that she's safe. This is something
that we as
men don't really take into consideration. When we talk to a woman, we don't. I mean, and you might have a crazy bitch that'll stick you with a steak knife that you might, but we don't think in the terms of
Brooklyn.
Okay, this chick is out of her mind.
Yeah.
But a woman goes, well, I don't know if I could be safe with this guy, if this guy's some kind of rapist or some kind of nut.
Also,
giant.
If you think about doing a regular handshake, man to man handshake,
right,
if you don't go 5 degrees off, then a man unconsciously believes that this person is threatening them. So if you go up to a woman and you're chest to chest with a woman, you're like, oh my God, this dude's gonna rape me.
Yeah.
And just having that and just being innocent about it, I think everything comes into play.
Yeah.
In those things.
Yeah.
Valentino, Dick, I'd like you to kind of maybe talk about that a little bit. The body language, the communication of that. And I mean, I go over it a lot, but it's nice to hear it from some. I feel as though we're on the same page. So
Definitely. Also, when you were talking about, by the way, about, you know, you want to be the best version of yourself and then you're enough. I totally agree that you need to have standards and you have to have criteria that I'm enough if I work on myself.
Right.
If I, let's say, whatever you choose to, I work out every day, or I read every day, or I'm conscious with what I eat.
Right.
Then I'm enough.
Right.
Because then you feel like, okay, I feel good. I feel happy because I'm doing what I really want to do.
Right.
And you shouldn't feel enough. You should feel bad if you're slacking off.
Sure.
If you're not going to work, if you're not working what you want to work on, right?
Sure.
So that's just a little point there. About the body language, the thing is, like, where would these guys learn this? There's nowhere in school. No.
Right.
So even like when you study psychology, it's not explained that there's pretty much no resources for these guys to learn this. So they just try it. They overwhelm the girl. And the thing is, usually the girl might be actually interested. She's like, okay, let's do this. Let's see where this will go. But the guy overdoes it and the girl freaks out and runs away.
Right.
It's like,
when you approach somebody who you don't know yet, they sometimes act like a reindeer. It's a very nice little, like, cute right. analogy. I'm just simplifying here. But it's like, what is that new stimulus? I don't know.
Right.
And if it's overwhelming, you just run away.
It's funny, it's funny you say that, because we have one of the things we have deers, here is we have bunnies, deers, and bears. So in terms of three different types of women. So the bunny is the super, like you, anything aggressive, I'm out, right? So even when you hand her the carrot, your hand has to be open. The carrot has to kind of roll around in
and
your hand.
It has to, like, go backwards.
Right,
it has to go backwards.
If you hold the carrot, that's too much, I'm out of here, you know. Oh, then you have the deer where it's kind of like, oh, an apple. All right, cool, let me. And then the bear, you have to hold a Snickers bar in one hand and then a 2x4 with a nail in it. And then when she reaches out the bike, you bang, you hit over the head. With the snake. And then she's like, good. My head hurts. All right. But I like Snickers better. So,
all right. Okay.
So, you know, and that the sliding scale of that from bunny deer to bear is kind of what we deal with. Because I think you would agree that the you have to gauge that energy.
Yeah. The thing is, like, we just had like a 30-day program in Toronto. Okay. So in Canada. So Canada.
30 days.
30 days. Wow. Yeah, we did like an more of an immersive program.
I don't know, Valentine. I don't know if I want to see you 30 days.
Seeing my red beard. Yeah, I know. But that actually, like, really changes you, because that's where you can build a habit. That's how you can go deep. That's how we have enough time to actually dive and find out what kind of beliefs hold you back. But right now, I just want to, like, give anybody who's listening kind of like a quick breakdown with the body language.
Sure.
So the thing with body language is a big misconception is that people think that the shape of their body actually matters a lot. Like, however you stand. Mm-hmm. It's much more, where do you put your energy? Okay.
Fair enough.
So how do you determine where is your energy put? It's determined by where you're squaring up towards. Mm-hmm. So if you're squaring up towards someone, it's first of all, even if you look at a party, if you guys think of a party and you see a guy, like, in a girl's face, like, squared up, like, looking at her, you're like, oh, he's trying to get her. He's trying to pick her up.
Right.
If that's your girlfriend, you go in there, you're like, what the fuck's happening?
Right.
This guy's going for her. It puts pressure on her.
Well, you go, bitch, do what you want to do. I mean, I'm that dope.
Yeah, but it's like,
you don't know,
like,
anyway.
Some guys, like, let's say the girl's we call it like a mouse or like a bunny or a reindeer, then she might be overwhelmed. You want to save her.
Right.
But if the guy is on his side, side by side with the girl like this,
right,
he can actually be much closer. It's much easier to build physical rapport.
Right.
And it doesn't really come across like you're trying something.
Right.
Because the way that I teach it, the way I do with all my students, is you can't tell. Like, you would see me wherever, New Union Square, in a club, in a bookstore, you wouldn't be able to tell what's happening.
Right.
Like, in Toronto, there was, like, this one mall where they actually banned pickup. Like,
really?
Like, literally banned pickup. Like, a Reddit article went, like, crazy. It's called the Eden Center. And they literally banned it.
Right.
Because there were too many guys running out. So, oi, you, come here. Oi, you, come here. And, like, calling them, like, animal names and stupid shit like that.
Right.
But we would go there every single day.
And they wouldn't know
and
you
would. Nothing would happen. Right. We would always go to the same bookstore. And the bookstore is, like, super small.
Right.
We go there every single day. I go there with three guys. We just socialize in the bookstore. It's also great place to, like, find girls that actually read and, like, work on themselves.
Yeah. Right.
That's lovely.
I like going to McDonald's where I get a bitch to eat. I like a bitch to eat McNuggets.
Tomatoes, tomato. Yeah.
Cookies and McNuggets. Or like a barbecue place.
Oh, okay.
Where a bitch would eat a pork shoulder. I like a nice bitch.
Exactly. Like, wherever you go, you know, it already kind of, like, determines what kind of girls that there are.
Yeah, yeah.
So,
how many of those girls are actually single anymore these
eating
days?
Eating pork shoulder?
You know?
Yeah.
They're all
eating
taken.
Pork shoulder?
They're all taken. They're all you know, you go in there and then...
I like a bitch that goes eat the skin and the fat off the pork
see
shoulder.
A beautiful lady just going right at a rack of ribs
just
and you're like, somebody,
it.
She's not
just
single.
House in it.
That doesn't last for long.
I love America.
LT, where are you from originally? What is your background and where do you reside? All that.
Yeah. Good stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. I'll just close this one real quick and then I'll tell you like a little bit more of my backstory. So, yeah. So the point is doing it in a way that it's just natural.
It's natural.
And it feels, and the girl feels like it just kind of happens.
Right.
Right. And then that's the right way, because if you really think about whenever you actually had an interaction that led somewhere or led into a relationship, it usually just kind of happened. But the thing is, it usually just, you know, happens once in a year.
Right.
If you know how you can proactively like get into those situations, it's like when you're working hard.
This is when a woman goes, I just felt the chemistry. It was just awesome. Stupid, it's not chemistry. Dumb bitch, we did it to you.
Not some magic bullshit.
Well, I was on Percocet.
But yeah, I get what you're saying. It should feel natural. It feels natural. And the only way that it feels natural is, it's interesting that you said a 30-day, like you did the 30, which is where you really immerse somebody and so that it becomes a natural course.
It becomes a habit. They can't like not live that way anymore. Right. It's totally crazy.
Right,
so
right.
We kind of like, did it in Toronto. Now we're going to do it in LA starting 9th of November. So that I'm really looking for like towards to that one, since LA is one of my favorite places to go and stuff. Yeah.
Danny, I want you to tell. Danny's a Beige Phillip fan. I mean, he's a fan of yours. That's why you're here as well. And I want you to tell, because some of the things that I deal with also is the relationship situation after the situation. Danny's been in a relationship for 10 years.
10 years.
Yeah. You mean like breakup? Or what do you mean?
Well, no, he's
how
in
old
the relationship.
Are you? I thought you were like 17.
Yeah, well, it was his high school sweetheart.
I started that five.
But here's what's interesting. He came in today, sat down, his guy, because you know, Andre, you were late.
The cops.
Got arrested.
5-0 got me.
But Danny, would you tell this? Yeah, okay.
Yeah, so... yeah, my girl, she got really upset with me because I didn't call her and let her know I was going to be at the Philly Temple University homecoming. I was supposed to go to the march, the Million Man March, but I ended up in Philly, you know, like people do sometimes.
And let's be honest, probably 1,000 niggas out there.
Anyway. I mean, it was going to be a sausage fest in D.C. So, I went to the homecoming.
Right.
And she got upset and she said, "You didn't call me." And I thought... I just want to say
there's a lot of pork shoulder bitches that went out to the Million Man March, though.
That's a fact.
Yeah.
They didn't march.
No, well, they kind of shuffled. They shuffled around.
Did some snacking.
So I thought, you know, WWDD, you know, what would Dante do? And I just played off any type of...
Wait, you told her that you were going to be in D.C.?
I was supposed to be in D.C.
But you ended up in Philly.
I ended up in Philly.
Completely different state.
Completely different state.
Cool,
and
cool.
She was... That sent her. Especially because I didn't tell her.
Right.
So I said, all right.
Why didn't you tell her?
I was driving. You know what I mean? Like, I'm driving, so
you
I don't have the time.
You didn't stop for gas?
Nah, I filled up before I left.
Yeah, so, Philly's only an hour and a half away.
I mean, it is right there.
It's a hot minute.
2 hours at the most.
You got on the wrong express.
You're not dating him, Mara.
You're about to get in trouble again.
I just don't know why you wouldn't tell her.
Oh,
what if
that's exactly how she sees it. She's like, why wouldn't you tell me? I'm driving. I don't have the time to text you. And I have my guys in the car, so I'm not going
to... You can't ask one of your dudes to text her?
No, you don't. You don't do that.
Why I do that?
Yeah, I never handle my phone.
Yeah,
because
you're a girl. What is it? Do you realize what I would do to Andre if he said, yo, text my girl?
Text my girl?
Tell her you.
I'm going to be what I'm supposed to.
Why don't you just juggle the balls while you're sucking cock?
I thought this was a masculine, like, you can be as masculine as you want.
Yeah, you don't text. Yeah, I mean, if you're doing what you're doing, you let her know afterwards.
Yeah,
whatever.
Exactly.
I mean, but he could have. Sure, he could have said, but go ahead.
In the ideal world, that could have happened, but it didn't, unfortunately, for her emotions. And what happened was she got upset. She texted me a bunch of heat, and I said, you know what? I'm not going to think about this. I let her know that I'm safe. You know, I'm going to have a good time. So that was on Saturday. Sunday, I came back. I was drunk. So I'm recovering from the hangover. And
you know about being drunk.
No idea.
So on Monday, you know, she says, I'm hungry. And she's texting me, you know, she wants to go out to get something to eat. But the way she's texting me, she's being kind of off. She's letting me know that I'm not feeling you.
You can feel the tingle in your balls.
Yeah, I feel it coming.
So let me just say this, Valentine. We have a terminology to say, when you feel the tingle in your balls, means you're getting ready to get kicked in the nuts. So it's that feeling you feel like she's pushed. This is not where it should be.
Right.
That happens so often. I just want to know how it ends.
So you know, it's not balanced, and I feel it. So then, I say, you know what? Let's go get something to eat. I'm going to take her to a restaurant.
Mm-hmm. She gets in the car and her energy already is kind of off. But I'm just going to ignore it for the time being. And then we get into the conversation. The first question she asked me is, did you get any numbers in Philly? So I'm like, okay, this is exactly where you want to be.
What I felt in the first place, right?
So, you know, I'm like, why would you ask me that? She said, it's not crazy. We know how you are. You know, you want to be charismatic. You want to have a good time. I say, yeah, but no, I didn't get any numbers in Philly. But I'm offended that this is the first thing that you asked me.
And you're taking her to eat.
Exactly. Right. I mean, you're gonna be upset on my dollar? Like,
why does that make you, like, feel offended?
Because, so I'm looking for a good night, right? And in my head, I put this all behind me. So the fact that when you think of Philly, you think of numbers as opposed to what happened in general is what offended me, because you just showed me that when I said you felt a way about me going there and you telling me you didn't, but the first thing you're thinking about is me and other women.
I don't
women.
Think she was feeling, I feel like that's always just a passive aggressive sure. way to enter a conversation. I don't think that her first question, it was just something that she could say. That's what girls
well, I don't
do.
Think
do
she's mean? Really present. I don't think she was present in the fact that she was being passive. I think she was just being passive aggressive.
You might have put it in the past, but she hasn't put it in the past.
Right, but that's what he's saying.
Right,
he's
right.
saying he felt that energy already, and right. so.
And then?
But he wants to take her to dinner, but go ahead.
Yeah, so then, you know, we get into the conversation, and then it turns into I say this, she says that, and we get into an argument. I say, you know what? I'm no longer having fun anymore. So I'm turning around. I'm taking you back home.
Nice.
And then she got so frustrated. She's like, oh, you being a corny ass nigga. And I'm like, all right, well, you're going to be
she
a hungry ass
down.
Bitch. It's going to be what it is.
She doubled down.
She doubled down.
Yeah, like you mad, I'm mad. But the night is not going to go the way that you thought it was going to go with that attitude.
Because it's clearly not going the way I wanted it to go.
Pretty so much. There's a fire going. You said, I don't like this. There's a fire. I'm going to put it out.
Yeah.
And she started throwing kerosene on it.
He said there's a fire going on. He goes, I'm going to run the other way.
Yeah, right, that's right.
Yeah, he didn't think of
I'm over it. You know what I mean? Like, so right. I took it back home, and I showed her where the Wendy's was at. So she said, all right, you know what? She apologized for the night because she realized what happened. And the
she
fact
apologized
that
because
you
didn't
talk, you didn't know that moment. She when he doubled down and said, look, we're not doing this. Yeah. We're not doing this. I'm taking you back home. Because you were going
to
go pay for feed her and everything. And then you go, you want another water, bro? Want another one? Get him another one. There's one in the freezer. And you said, look, I'm not tolerating. I'm not fighting with you, but I'm also not tolerating this behavior.
Right.
You turned around and then she apologized and she goes.
Yeah, I mean, she was, and it took everything, every bit of her to apologize because she felt like, you know, I'm being stubborn. I say, if I'm being stubborn, you're being stubborn, when, you know, nothing's going to come of this. But understand this.
And you weren't yelling. You weren't angry.
I wasn't yelling at all.
Which is important because when you yell in that situation, then she doesn't hear anything. Now you have offended her because because you're yelling. Now it becomes about, well, you yelled at me.
Right, right,
right.
Now I'm off. So
right.
She said, you know, she apologized and she went to Wendy's and then she called me back later. She went to Wendy's.
She's hungry.
She called me back later and, you know, we had a good night afterwards. But the thing is, had I took her to eat, that dinner would have been wrong. I would have felt away by paying for it.
Right.
The drive back would have been wrong.
Well,
you know?
I think you missed the part is that she apologized and she was like, well, why can't this night be the way, why do you have to mess up the night?
And
why can't it just continue to be what it was going to be? But what she doesn't understand is that she's the one that took the night and twisted it. She sent it off into the woods already.
Yeah.
And all you did was just go, my value is important in this. I'm not going to allow you to just take my life and twist it the way you want and bend to this because I'm not being unreasonable. Now, one of the things
she just approached it and was like, you know, I still feel offended that you didn't tell me that you're going to a completely different state at a completely different place and to a completely different
now
thing.
And what would you have said?
What would
if
you
she
have
said
that?
Oh, I apologize for offending you.
Right.
That's it. Like if she said I'm offended, I'd be like, oh my bad. Oh, you know, I didn't mean that.
We know guy. We don't really want to make our girl angry. You know, that's not what we really want the peace anyway. And most of the time, and you would testify to this, we get in relationships, we get into a bigger problem because of the fact that we don't speak up in terms of what our happiness is. And we don't draw the line and say, look, I'm not.
But then also that's something that the women, like, they'll put in their head as okay, so he's going to tell me he's doing one thing, and he could be doing 9 million other things because it's happened before.
Right.
Exactly. Exactly. Sure. I think, like, the biggest problem here is that you look at just, like, the symptoms.
Uh-huh.
It's like, why didn't you tell me about this symptom? Why didn't you tell me about this symptom? Like, it's more when you look at it deeper, but it's hard to make a judgment because I don't know your girlfriend or your girl.
I know her.
and but the way it looks, like, there's pretty much one of the best books ever written about relationships. It's called Attached. So this is not my concept. I just take it from there. Is that you have different attachment types, different relationship types.
Sure.
And people are either anxious, secure, or avoidant.
Are you saying as a
in
type,
a relationship,
or
as
are
a
you
type,
saying
in an attachment?
As from each engagement can be different.
Just towards a romantic relationship. So his girlfriend comes across anxious.
Mm-hmm.
His girlfriend's like, I don't know if we're going to stay together. And anything that could kind of like hint that this might go away, she freaks the fuck out. She feels insecure and she doesn't know how to communicate.
Sure, sure.
He comes across a little like between secure and avoidant, little bit. Because if you are avoidant and the other person's anxious, the more anxious he becomes, the more avoidant you are.
And it doesn't work.
And just like the way to solve that is not that everyone needs to be secure, but one person in the relationship has to be secure. If you're secure, nothing can really upset you. You know what I mean?
Well, yeah, I would challenge that if you have a guy who's not secure in any relationship, the relationship is doomed to fail anyway. So it's not even a situation where one person, the guy has to be secure and confident because a woman is...
It's not about being secure and confident. It's being a secure attachment type, a secure relationship type.
Well,
you can
But here's what I would disagree. I'm not disagree, but something I would bring to your attention that anytime a woman feels as though she's with a weak man, she will eventually. And this goes to we got a shout out to Christopher Ryan. We just some of the stuff that I base a lot of my philosophies on is sex at dawn, which is it's an instinctual drive that women want to be comfortable. They want their man to be decisive and they want him to be confident. They want to feel safe with him. And when you are sporadic about your decisions and stuff, then that makes them anxious and insecure.
Yes. No. Totally agree. Like,
but that goes to
I'm just trying to put this like whole book in like two sentences.
Right, okay.
Like, you got to read the whole thing. But, you know, you can have, for example, like a rock star. He's very secure, very confident
in his actions. Right, because he has options.
But
he has options.
But then he might be more avoidant. He doesn't actually want to get into a relationship, right? Same thing with me. It's really hard to get in a relationship with me because I'm traveling constantly. I'm always like out meeting people. It's very hard to like spike up and like keep me there.
Right.
It's pretty much impossible with the lifestyle that I have at this point.
Right.
So the guy, and we're like, you know, mostly guys here and one girl, you should be focused on becoming the secure type. Right? You want to be the secure in the relationship. So when the girl is either like not texting you, I have like one special girl like that in Toronto. She was like, just like in the beginning, she would like always kind of avoid, but then after a while, she would like really get into it. But she's afraid because she was hurt in the past. So if she would commit, then she knows, oh shit, if I just let go, I might get hurt.
Right.
So you need to like focus on being the secure type and not reacting. Right.
Well, I don't think he reacted. Do you think he reacted in that situation?
In a sense, it's like when the girl is like, well, why did you tell me? Did you get any numbers? You want to find out why she's saying that.
Does she care
about the numbers?
Of course.
She really care?
No, of course she does.
No, she's scared that she would lose him.
Right. But she sees these numbers as a representation.
It's a symptom, right?
She sees it as a representation of her insecurity.
So he's like, well, and then
she's
then
not
you react
good enough
on the same
that
level.
He might leave or whatever.
And
but
then
he's
you
not,
react on the same level, you
yeah,
know?
But here,
and you're like, well, no, I didn't get the numbers. Why are you asking me all these questions? I'm just social. You don't like me being social?
But
she's scared that he would, like, walk away.
Absolutely.
So that's what you need to address.
Absolutely. But
you know?
Here's an interesting concept with that. If she's afraid to walk away, she's more invested than he is. That's just the way it is. And so here's a situation where he's saying, listen, this is my girl. She's hungry. I love her. I want to feed her. I want things to be, I want to do something nice for her. Gets his money, picks her up, takes her wherever she takes her to. He wasn't taking her to Wendy's. He was taking her to a place called Peaches, which is a really nice kind of soul food restaurant. It's kind of cool out and stuff. So he's like, man, I want to spend some time with my girl. I've been, he probably was, and I'm just assuming he probably missed her because he wasn't away. Cause well, you know, she's what you call your couch. You know, that's your couch and your blanket. Well, I call it a couch because it's the chick that you're just comfortable with, that she's part of your furniture, you know, and you don't want to not, if somebody just comes and steals your furniture and gets rid of your furniture, you go, who took my couch? You know? So I think.
I love her face.
It's like that.
You are a couch. See, man. But that's not a bad thing. It's, we love the fucking couch. Like, it's
immense value.
I mean, I know it doesn't sound special.
That's what it is. It's just the sound of it. That's all it is. They don't care about your definition.
All she heard was
a couch.
She heard the word couch. And then he just checked the fuck out.
Which, this is exactly my point. My point was that she put these definitions and represented this situation the way she wanted to represent it, with no concern about, she didn't go, what do you mean by that? You know? She just gets it's this kind of visceral response to something. I don't like it. You know, I don't like it. Whatever. Like,
so does she have to change, or do you have to, like, change your communication?
I think it has to. I think that you don't tolerate... You don't tolerate disrespect. I don't tolerate it at all. And that's one of the things.
Isn't she also being disrespected by not being told where she was going?
Yes, but here's the thing.
Why is that? Why are her feelings not valid?
It's not that her feelings are not valid. Here's the thing. If she says to him, hey, I feel like it was disrespectful. I care about you. You told me you were going here. And he would go, look, I'm sorry. I'm just trying to change plans. I apologize. And she could say, well, listen, I, you know.
Has this happened before? Have you done this before?
I've done stuff like this, I think.
Why do you do that?
It's not the same, though. It's not the same. What it said to me was...
Why did you feel like you should communicate with her?
Like, if I got numbers, right, then I would have had the same reaction as I did without the numbers.
Well, that's not the point. The point is that she's saying, if this is a pattern that she's seeing and she's insecure about the pattern.
Exactly.
So it's not wrong with the fact... look, I'm not saying that she can't get upset because she's uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. What I'm saying is... You cannot reward the way in which she communicates what her problem is. So
why don't you take control of that conversation and say, I understand you feel disrespected
absolutely.
For the way that
I absolutely think you should do that again. I absolutely think you should do
exactly.
that.
Exactly.
But if you keep doing that, I mean, she should leave. But
okay, but here's the thing. Here's the thing. If he does something wrong, right, and if she does something wrong and he goes and he smacks her upside the head, right? That would be an inappropriate way for him to communicate the fact that he's...
Oh, I'm not... I am completely agreeing with you that I know why she did what she did and I know that it was wrong.
And the reason why she does it is because she's gotten away with doing it like that before instead of communicating really what was on her mind.
Well, 10 years of practice.
Right.
Right.
Exactly. And so, I've only been doing Beige Phillip for 3 years. So this is... This him taking a stand is the start of it. And I would absolutely say that if you're going to go... If you can't do those things because just flipping the script and going wherever the fuck you want to go when you're saying I'm going to be here and you're going to be there. It's a lack of credibility. That shows a lack of credibility, which the reason why she'll trust you is because you're credible. Because credibility means I say what I mean, I do what I say. So if you say, and I'm not saying that there's not circumstances where you don't, you know, there's things happen and things fuck up. But if you fuck up, you go, hey, look, it's just like I said to you, we were talking about your situation, right?
I got a little drunk.
Right. Got a little drunk.
That's the beginning. She got a little drunk.
And her dude was pissed off because she was drunk and she
had a nip slip.
So it's the best way for my story.
And he
got a little drunk.
We got real drunk at work. Everybody got drunk.
Right.
But I got really drunk. And I'm the girl there. Everybody else drinks. We all drink the same. And I got wasted.
Right.
And then I didn't react to him saying something because I was drunk.
You weren't conscious.
And then I was like, whatevs. And I got in bed. And then he
knocked
left.
Out.
Yeah.
Right. And then he was like, you don't respect me. You threw my beer out. You ran, and he ran out.
I was like,
and then he got mad at her because, and she passed out. So she didn't even hear his rant. And then he got mad because she didn't chase after him. So there's a lot of bitch ass shit here.
That's different.
Like
there's a lot
of bitch ass shit because here, why would you run out if you don't want to leave me, then why would you run out? Why would you run out?
Stop.
So that's a lack of credibility because you're doing something to get a reaction, which is the same thing that she's doing. She's doing something to get a reaction.
Yeah.
So I think, yes, you have to be credible. If you say you're going to do something, or I say, listen, I'll go where I want, and I don't like somebody asking me where I'm going. Well, if you can say that, and that could be the parameters of your relationship, and then she can either go.
She called him a corny nigga.
Right. And then she called him a corny ass nigga.
I was like, all right, so you're going to be hungry then. Fuck it. Like,
nah, but it's just saying, you're going to do the fucking, I go wherever the fuck I want, don't ask me questions. She's sounding the type of bitch that's just be like, okay, nigga. You're going to see a couple Instagram pictures that you don't want to see.
She has opportunities to do that. And I always tell her, I say, if there's anything that you want to do that you're not doing because you're with me, please, by all means, do that right now. I want to know who you are. You know, I don't want to meet you when we're single. You know what I'm saying? Like, sometimes people break up and all of a sudden you see who they were after the fact. Like, I want to see who you are now. So who I am.
Here's what's interesting, because I agree with Valentino in a sense that I think that you as a man, you have to be strong enough to protect your woman from her emotions. You have to be strong enough to protect your relationship from her emotions, and you have to be strong enough to protect yourself from her emotions, because when she feels certain things, this kind of anxiousness, she'll scorch the earth. She'll fuck everything up because emotionally she's in a place where she's with. So you have to do that. But I think you also, the first thing that you have to establish is that you're not going to allow somebody to disrespect you, and not going to, and if you, you know, one of the things, like, if you.
Do you think she really meant that disrespectfully? Because what I really think, when I picture myself in that situation, what I think, she just wants to be understood. And I don't think she felt understood.
Absolutely.
She's just a way about going about it.
She didn't want you to solve a problem. She didn't probably want you to, give her a promise right now. First, she wanted you to just listen, understand her. Look, baby, I know that, you know, I told you I would go there and I didn't go where I told you I would go.
I
can understand how you feel right now. And then just have her talk. She's like, look, I was lying in bed. I was like imagining certain things. I know you wouldn't do it, but I couldn't help it. And she just wanted to feel understood. She didn't want
Absolutely.
The problem to be fixed.
That's Absolutely.
Like usually even like when you're in a relationship and you get home, or you're at home and then your woman comes home. And she tells you about the problems she has with her boss, with everything.
She wants
to
be heard.
She doesn't want you to fix anything.
She just wants to hear it.
She just wants to feel understood. Okay, there's somebody that gets me.
Right.
And then she feel much, much better.
But I would say this. We're also talking about a relationship that has been on track all along. It's already awry. If she's calling him a corny ass nigga, that it's pretty much it's off the track already.
If somebody gets hurt, then you hurt more.
Right.
Yeah,
you hurt more.
Here's what I think, and that's a reflection of you, because a woman is a reflection of the guy she's with. So if she feels insecure and then you do something worse and you make it worse, then it gets worse and then it's blah 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 and it gets out of hand. You have to be. But I think to the same token, go listen. I'm not really happy. I'm not doing this. Is also stopping the nonsense. I mean, there's a lot of nonsense that went on before that that was allowed to happen.
Right.
Like, if you have done what Valentino had said in the first place, was like, listen, I was hanging out with my friends and this, and that was my oversight, and I love you, and I just, you know, it just didn't happen, and I won't let that happen again. Then that probably would have resolved the whole thing, you kind of know that she's pissed. That you knew she was pissed. You deep down, you know, you just didn't really give a fuck.
I mean, what happened was she started off pissed. That's her starting point. And I said, you know what? I'm not gonna dive into this.
Or
pissed
hurt.
Is the word that she gave me. Pissed. So, and
but
I know,
do you
I know,
think
I know.
She was hurt, or she was just angry.
She was, she's pissed. No, she's pissed. I know when she's pissed. I don't know when she's hurt.
I think it's a little bit of both.
I think she's
angry.
Go really deep. If someone's pissed, it's just because you're hurt and you just don't show it. You show
it's
it as anger.
It's mostly fear.
Deep
it's,
inside.
It's fear more than anything else.
It was pain. It was no pain.
Yeah,
that.
But it's
like,
fear. it is fear, and fear is where it comes from. Insecurity of fear is he exactly. Because it sounds very crazy to a guy, because you know a lot of times, but not really. There's guys that feel that same way, because your guy was like, "You didn't chase me, so you don't love me." No, I didn't chase you. I didn't know, but that's what he. That's the in essence. He got mad at her because she didn't chase him, which really is you didn't chase me because you didn't chase me, you don't love me. Which is I didn't chase you because I was drunk off my ass and I just didn't hear you, which is the real answer. And so she's going.
Well, that's not up for debate. Yes, that's we've established that.
But so what's happening in this situation is she's going. I'm pissed, but she's not pissed. She's like, I feel like you went somewhere and was hiding something from me, and you were getting numbers,
right,
and I feel like this is not my. I'm not enough, and you're going to go get somebody else, and you're going
to leave. Because women spiral. If you think, if you're like, oh, my gosh, if he can lie to me about this, he can lie about B, C, D, and E.
Which is really absurd because just because you beat people up don't mean you murder people. I mean, sometimes people die. That happens.
I got lost.
Not murder.
I don't know where that came from.
Listen, 96 was a rough year.
I mean, come on. You hit somebody and they hit their head on the curb or something.
You ain't got nothing to do with that.
That wasn't my intent.
Who the one that made the sidewalk? Not you?
Not me.
That's what I'm saying.
And I'm saying learn how to fall.
Come on now. Shoulder roll, brother.
Hands up.
But what I'm saying is you have to manage that. And I think that the move you made, which way it was like, look, I'm not doing this and I'm going is I think it's a good move. I just think it's a move way too late. Like you have to learn to.
You are moving Mara right now. Look at that.
What are some other issues?
I got a cold. I don't have feelings. Come on.
What are some other issues that you've been experiencing with? Because this is just one.
In general, we're really good.
Hey. I mean, 25. So we've been together since I was, 15.
Wow.
15.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's good.
So I learned everything, that about dating with her.
Right, but you're also growing, it's 10 fucking years.
Yeah.
Like, holy shit.
That's when you clock out for a lot of people.
That's when you go, this bitch, again?
So, really?
Damn, son.
You're fucking her. You go, we're going to fuck this bitch again. And she's smoking hot.
Yeah, she's a...
Fire!
Peace.
So, yeah. But...
My longest
mine, though. You know what I mean? Like, I love it, but at the same time, it's like,
yeah, I think.
Go
you're
through ups and downs.
You're 16 years old.
That's what I'm saying.
You're you are 7 years old.
I'm the strongest 7 year old ever.
You had an 8 month match. That is awesome. All the way from first grade to seventh grade.
I even took a picture with her.
Gotcha.
Dude.
Yeah, but that was a school picture.
All right, but she was there. I ain't have to hug her.
He's 20 with a 7 year old reading level. You read that wrong.
Fuck all of y'all.
So, but I say one of the things that I say is that, like you're right. Valentine is going to the root of it, where the problem was in the root, but you still have to go. I'm not going to tolerate this kind of behavior.
I don't think the move was too late. I mean, the move
it wasn't.
Is,
not,
he could.
So.
What I'm saying is, he could have. What Valentino said was
once she got into the car and she's like, "What about the numbers?" That's when you just like interrupt the whole thing.
Stop.
And you just sit there for 5 minutes, 10 minutes in the car, get to the root, and it's done. If you actually care about it. If you don't care about it, dude, fucking don't.
I laughed
like, stop.
At it. I laughed. At it. I'm like, really? Stop. That's what you're gonna do? That's how we starting this.
Mm. Then stop being with her and like experience other people, other experiences. Because the thing is also like once you committed 10 years to something, you're like, dude, I've already been here 10 years.
Right.
I've already, but the same thing happens in like a good sense. Like when you're like, look, I've already been working out every single day for the last 3 months. You're going to keep working out because it's more pain to not do it because you already committed. You identify yourself with that. And I mean, you really, what happens with most guys that they actually like become, they get like secure enough that they're like, okay, this is me. That happens when you're around like 21, 22, 23, usually even later, but you come across very, very mature. So that happened with her there, right?
Right.
So you identify yourself with her.
Right.
Okay. And you really have to like go deep and see what is the reason that I'm with her? Why am I with this girl? Why maybe shouldn't I be with this girl? I'm not saying do one or the other. I'm just saying make a conscious decision and don't be stuck in like a pattern just because you've been doing it for
like
the last
time. Tell me, break up with my girl? Is that what I'm getting? Break up with her?
No. I wouldn't.
No.
What I'm saying, you really need to figure out, reevaluate
what it is.
Why? Because you want to get into a position. Because what most people say is love, is actually has nothing to do with like really loving someone. Because if you love someone that's just one way street, you don't give a damn if they love you back. All you want is them to be happy. 100% whatever they do, and you want them to like self-actualize themselves. That's all you want.
Right.
That's all you want. But 90 to 95% of relationships, all that it is like, I'm not happy, but so I need you to be happy, and you need me to be happy.
Right.
So we need each other to be happy, and that's called neediness, and that's actually not coming from the right place. And at one point, you know, you might marry, you get kids, and then it's just like, shit, this is not it.
And then you're like 40, fat, and done. I don't need her to be happy, though.
I'm not saying that. This is very general. I'm not like
but
just
I think
saying
what's,
that.
I think
but, like,
what's
the
happening
finding
also.
The ways, right? And then having, being sure that, look, I'm in an independent state right now. Because what it's called is like being codependent. I need someone to be happy. They need me. But if you're independent, it means if you're with someone, if you're not with someone, you're same level of happiness. And then you find someone who's on the same level, you get to like an interdependent state where you with her are much, much better. It's not just 1 + 1 = 1, like 2.
I don't know if I agree with that,
Valentine.
I don't know if I agree with that.
But you like actually have someone who supports you in your mission.
I don't know if I agree with that in the sense that because a man's value is directly related to his ability to provide. In our society, your value, a man's value is directly related into his ability to provide.
Provide
whatever it is, whatever she needs. Like a woman
are you talking about materialistic stuff?
Whatever she needs. Your value in her mind is whether or not you can provide, how you can provide. Now, so it's
I wouldn't say that's true in my sense, but we would have to be very clear about what do you mean with providing.
I think it could be financial, it could
food,
be
shelter.
Emotional, it could be any of those things. I mean, I think the nature, if you look at
mental stability,
support, so on and so forth. If we agree on the fact that you have to be the best version of yourself,
yeah,
then I'm not looking for somebody. In no shape or form am I looking for a woman to complete me. Good. I'm not even looking for a woman to make me better. It's great if she's supportive, but I'm going to be dope no matter what, whether the fuck she's around or she's not. I'm going to constantly be the best version of myself, despite her or with her.
Of course. Well, that's what I mean with being independent, right? That means you're amazing. You're on your path no matter what.
Absolutely.
And it's so hard, man, to find like
a woman who's on that same path.
But why do you think that's the case, though? Why is that the case?
Sure, because you can see like one of the things Harry's always says. Harry says you look at Super Bowl, you watch the Super Bowl,
yeah,
and there's Mark Cuban, Will Smith, and all these people, and then there's some blonde bitch sitting in the back, right? Hot blonde bitch, and you go, well, who is the blonde bitch
up in the owner's box?
Yeah, up in the box.
And
in the Super Bowl.
That's what you got to do to get into the owner's box.
That's what you
got to
do. You got to own
the
team, be Mark Cuban, be the greatest actor ever, do multiple films, Independence 1, 2, and 3, and then you could be just some hot blonde bitch and be in the Super Bowl box.
Let's ask Marta. That's your name, right?
Marta.
Mara. Mm-hmm. Mara. Okay.
But I'm going to call you Marta from now on.
It's like Europeans, you know. For us, like some American names are like very special. Okay. So if you think of a guy who just, you know, provides you with a car, with shelter, with food, he looks after you, he makes sure you have the best life, buys you the nicest clothes, everything.
Uh-huh.
But he's super busy, he's working, he's almost never home, but he provides with everything you need. Or you look at a guy that whenever he's with you, he like looks into your eyes, you feel that he's present. You feel that he really cares about how you feel. He gets your emotions out. He gets you to levels, even like sexually, emotionally, that most that you couldn't do with anybody else. But he might be broke.
Me.
Well,
what?
What? What? If you
value it.
Well,
that could actually
it,
be the same person because you said.
Totally, totally. But yeah. What is, if you had to choose one, what would give you more of a fulfilled life?
It just, you know, depends what I mean? On what kind of bum ass bitch you are.
And
that's what it
and,
is. Because you got a chick who just,
is,
who, women who use their sex and their resources to gain resources.
Because what I like, what you said before with like the, what did you call it? The bunny, the reindeer,
bunny,
and the
bunny,
bear?
Bunny,
deer, and, deer, and bear.
Deer
and a bear.
And the bear. We have kind of like a similar like way of looking at it,
yeah.
Where you can, you know, kind of like categorize a girl into
right.
One of three.
Right.
Either you say she's extroverted, which means she likes to talk, she's
right.
Outgoing,
an
she's
otter?
Social.
Either. That's another brand.
I was like, they actually
no,
like to be like, together.
Yeah, he's not adding it.
They made for life.
Either.
Either.
Yeah, yeah. He's not adding good. Animals good. To the list.
I was like, they're so cute.
I've swept a few otters.
A couple of gazelles in
the
bitch.
And she used to swim on her back and then crush oysters on her chest.
Bang, 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 bang.
That's the funny. That's like the funny thing because like in my entire company, everyone is like native English speaker,
oh, okay.
Like except me. So I say either, and everyone's like, right, like what? And I was like, okay, sorry, either. Well, I'm getting there. So she's either extroverted, likes to go out, be
sure.
Social, everything, or she's more neurotic, a little bit self-conscious.
Sure, sure.
She anything could freak her out. She thinks like the world hates her.
Jewish.
All that stuff. I like how you guys spiking this up. Or the third one is she's a little bit psychotic, crazy party bitch.
Puerto
if
Rican.
You want.
Puerto Rican.
So we have the honor.
Let
we have the Jewish
son,
girl.
Let
and
me
we
tell
have
you something. I come Latino hot blood. Don't mess with me because I'll style you.
Watch the heights.
So you have like those three types, right? You can always tell one girl is more like introverted, one's more extroverted, but still sane. And then you have the one girl that's just crazy, psychotic, goes up and down, hot and cold. And all these three girls, that's the most like exciting thing about this. They're attracted to one specific type of guy more than to anything else.
Yeah.
So it was like a psychology, like it was a study done in the UK. I'll give you the
okay.
Thing.
Okay.
This was like done with thousands,
you
thousands
say an
of people.
Initial attraction, because here's the problem. Like I say this all the time. No,
it will
girl,
just work. It will just work
right.
In the long run.
Right.
If you're not that, it won't work in the long run. So
I get that because
yeah.
Like we had Stephanie Santiago here and
yeah.
She is attracted to sort of thuggish guys
sort
overall.
Of.
Like
yeah.
Yeah. He's gone. Dante's like
Dante, we're still recording.
I'm like that.
Get back here.
I was like, why is Valentino in my dream? All of you get out. Except Mara, take your pants off.
So if you look at it, what kind of guy do you think would like the extroverted type of girl be attracted to? If you had what kind of guy, if you had to like put like certain characteristics on him?
Probably a strong guy. Like a
strong guy.
Like a strong
yeah,
guy.
An alpha male.
An my alpha protector. Male.
Yeah.
Very good. They called it the leader. Somebody who's the social leader, the leader of the group, makes the decisions.
Right.
The girl can be next to him, and he enables her to be more social, to
right.
Be more extrovert, to
sure.
Meet more people.
Yeah.
What about the neurotic girl, the girl that's like a little bit shy and she doesn't really know what she's doing?
Like a creepy dude.
Andre. Oh.
In the corners.
What do you think? What do you think?
See,
what
now,
kind of guy?
I would think initially that it would be somebody who's very emotionally supportive. The problem I see
yeah.
With that would be that unfortunately feeds into that a little bit more, and that might be problematic. No?
It's emotionally supportive? What do you guys think? What kind
I
of guy?
I still think
the
it's the leader, to be
you
honest
think it's
with
all
you.
The same answer.
You think it's all the exact same?
No, I can't
same?
Be an alpha because then that comes off a little too strong for them. You know what I mean? Like
she has the decision to make to go out or stay inside in bed with you, she wants to stay inside
right.
And chill in bed with you. The
all
leader's
the
like,
want to stay
fuck
in bed with me.
Let's
yeah,
go out.
Netflix and chill.
So I like what he said. It's like it comes down to being nice. And nice guy gets right. those girls. Because he makes her feel good. He makes her feel appreciated. She's already, like, bad enough.
Right.
Where do those girls hang out? Until, Harry needs to know.
Until he's too nice, and then they become that
fuck
rich.
Me.
That, then they become...
The thing is that there's also, like, stuff that the leader has, the nice guy has, that it's not attractive. But yeah. I don't want to talk about that right now.
Right, right.
Psychotic girl. What kind of guy does she want?
Probably a
drug dealer. I think an equally psychotic
crazy
guy.
Crazy motherfucker.
The guy holding the Snickers and the bar.
The 2x4.
He's a carpenter and he works at a candy shop.
Also has his own vending machine company.
And a lot of change.
Yeah. Come on over, bitch.
Got a whole bag full of quarters.
Exactly. Exactly. She wants the badass.
Right. She wants the badass.
But the badass... is not the best match for the neurotic girl. The neurotic girl's like shy and in her head, and
here's what's interesting about that. It's funny that
so you, that's like always like the biggest kind of like attraction there. But then there's one more guy that is attractive to all of them.
Mm, okay,
thank what you, is it? Valens.
There you go.
I knew I brought you here for something. I knew we were getting to that, but I was gonna let you take that whole path and then just like fucking all right. Go get him a t-shirt.
What kind of guy would that be?
I think it's a guy that understands understands can regulate where he needs to be at what time at one point
that's,
in one place.
You're already thinking one step ahead. That's the Joker. Mm. Somebody who can be all of them.
I've read this thing. What's the name? The Joker, the leader. I've read this
so,
study. Yeah.
So the Joker can be everything. That's what I'm pretty much doing. When a guy comes,
that's what you're teaching.
Is being coached.
Yeah,
I can be all of it.
Right.
I can be like nice. I can be super supportive.
Right.
I can lead the whole group.
Right.
Or I can be a badass and do things that are unpredictable. That she's like, holy, I would have never thought he would do that.
Right. Right.
You can be all three of them and cut the negative stuff.
That's what I have
stuff.
A problem with, just not being unpredictable.
But like, there's one more guy that is always second choice. If she can, let's say, a neurotic a girl can get the nice guy.
She'll go to the one that she's most comfortable
with. She will go to the provider.
Right.
Provider is always second choice.
Right.
So a psychotic girl, if she can't have the badass, she will always choose the provider.
Right.
But she won't stay with him. She won't be in love with him. She won't be emotionally attached.
Right.
And that's where you go, where you have the... Right.
Where you get a girl. They'll marry that guy and then be in love with the Joker. They'll be in love with that wild card.
Exactly.
And they'll be texting him and you know, whatever, because she's the guy that brings that. Because
they want to be provided for, but that will never outdo, that will never kind of like ace the guy who actually feeds into her emotional needs.
Here's a concept that I've kind of dabbled with in my own, is one of the things I say to the woman is a reflection of the guy that she's with. What's interesting is what you say is you strive to be this Joker, this person that can do all of those things. But what happens is your energy changes her, because you're so fulfilled in your own self that you actually make. I mean, I've had you know, girls that I've dated, and they go, she's like, oh, now I don't suck dick, and then she's eating my ass, and I'm like, how? And they were like, she didn't even suck my dick. Yeah, she didn't suck your dick. That does. So I think what happens is women are really malleable in terms of what they can, based on. And one of the analogies that I use is that, you know, I don't know if you know Bonnie and Clyde, the bank robbers, the American bank robbers, right?
Gotcha.
Bonnie was a seamstress, right? She sold dresses because she met this bank robber and cop killer, Clyde. They hooked up, and then she was like, fuck the sundress. I'm killing cops and I'm robbing banks with you. And so that wasn't who she was. It was the guy that she was with that brought this, that actualized these all other things that she's explored, these other things, and then she became these things. So it's
interesting. That's when a girl isn't really secure in what she really is.
I don't think any of them are in that sense. I think they're all, and I think that they're not just women, but I think men too. The problem is when you get to that point where you really understand yourself,
yeah.
you are your best case study. So you have to do that work to figure out who you are and what you are and what, and then you also can become whatever you. But how many people do we know? And I mean, clearly, you have a company based on guys who don't know who they are and really haven't done the work in the innocent. The reason why I have this podcast and why guys call me and ask for advice is because they don't know. So I don't think that anybody, or male,
some people actually know who they are. They just don't have the skills in this one area.
To what extent?
They don't have the tools. You
to
know,
what
they,
extent is that? I mean, how often?
Where would you learn all of this? You know,
you have to put the work in, and nobody really is putting the work in. And you, like you said, there's no real. I mean, you're teaching it. I mean, there's guys I constantly get, and Mark can testify to say, you changed my life. Listening to you change, and I'm quite sure you get the same things because
it's a good feeling.
Because it's you know, and that becomes me just understanding that I'm. You know, all jokes aside, just that I'm helping people. It's that is important to me. Yeah. It's also important for me to tell somebody who's an asshole, fuck off. Like that, the balance of that is you're a dick. Fuck you. I'm okay
with
that.
You gotta fire some clients.
So the balance of that is important.
Keep your standard up.
And I think the balance of that is something that has become. Innate in who I am as a person, that I'm very comfortable with unhinging somebody's jaw, and I'm very comfortable with helping somebody who is desolate and can't and has no clue what
they want to change, right. But they don't know how.
Sure,
where
sure.
would they learn it? It's right. it can be very frustrating because right. you realize, damn, I have this problem. I don't know what to do, but where do I go? And the thing is, they don't have to like reinvent the wheel,
sure.
right? They're all. These resources are out there. All they need to do is like, you know, go out there, invest in themselves with money and commitment. That's the most important
but
thing.
But even
and
that,
time.
Even that to and say that, that to, is to something kinda, that people don't even understand how simple that is.
And then that will kind of like, you know, supercharge everything because you don't have to waste another like 5 or 10 years trying to figure out this by yourself. There's already people that figure it out. Like, just right. take advantage of it.
Anything you want to know, somebody already else knows it. They've already done something to teach. You just have to spend the time and the energy to kind of figure that out. What's interesting is like, okay, like
it doesn't even take that much money. You could
no,
you
it doesn't.
Google,
I mean,
you go to the library.
Sure,
you can,
exactly. Sure. It doesn't. Yeah. It just it takes commitment. The thing is, when you spend money, then you do it.
Right.
It's when I
and
did,
if you don't
I,
spend money, then it's a lot of times people don't invest. Yeah.
There's a lot of people with gym memberships that never use them.
Exactly.
Yeah, right. But they're not spending enough.
Well, here's
money,
what's interesting.
You know,
I'll just say this, just even from you being on the show, right now, just and Harry will testimony. This is the type of guy I am. I have another book. I got to read this book on attachment. That's going to happen.
It's called Attached. Yeah,
it's attached.
It's just attached.
It's literally like a pebble in my shoe right now. The fact that you mentioned this book and I'm not familiar to it, like as I'm doing
the
show,
yeah, the best book.
Is driving me crazy that I didn't read that book. Like that's how compulsive I am about expanding my knowledge and
amazing.
So on and so forth. The study about the Joker and stuff. I remember that now. I got to look that up again. Like but that's my thirst for knowledge. Like as I'm doing this show, I'm going shit. I got to get this book. I'm in my head right now. I have a friend of mine. He wants to know shit. He just asked me the question. And then I go, I don't know. And then he goes, oh, okay, right. And he just leaves it there. And he knows that I'm going to go home and research it. I mean, because I can't not know. And so that's who I've become and that's who I am. And
that's great.
And so he uses me, like he basically does, he'll ask me something he wants to know that he doesn't want to do the work. And he knows that I will come at, well, the reason why is this, whatever. We were driving down 10th Avenue, and he goes, man, it's interesting how the beams in that building were on angles. They were using, just ridiculous, but it was instead of using beams in a grid, they were using it as triangles. Mm-hmm. It was everything, the structure was, and I was like, well, why? He goes, I wonder why they do that. And he just knew that I would go, and I just... Like I did a dissertation on why so that's but I also know that people listen to the show. There's hundreds of 200,000 people that listen to the show. They're listening here because they care about what I say, and I don't want to give them information that I'm not comfortable with.
Exactly.
That I don't know.
You
there's a responsibility.
You should only talk about what you've actually done yourself. And that the thing like with
you come across like someone who can definitely be like that Joker type of guy, right? Because there's also people that, you know, they're just acting like the badass and they only get to psychotic girls. They're like, dude, I don't want to, like, all girls are crazy.
Right.
But no, no.
Oh, yeah, they are crazy. They are crazy, no. They are.
They are, but.
But anyway. You can manage that.
But the thing is, like, how do you act?
Right.
Is what you will attract.
Right.
I had this one guy, he's been doing it for 10 years, had like hundreds of girls, but he's like, none of them stay. They're all fucking nuts.
Right.
See, because you walk around in a leather jacket, look like a badass, and you just scream at chicks.
Right.
So the only ones that will react
that's
to that.
That's what you're attracting. Right. Yeah, that's right. You get
the psychotic girls. If you look at the like reindeers, the neurotic ones, you go up like that, they run away.
Right.
And
he,
in his mind, he's like, I wasn't loud enough. I need to be stronger. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah. So it's what you—it's the image you set is also what you're bringing back in, is what you're saying.
I know that whenever I wear my Argyle sweater,
what he was saying, you know,
whenever I put on my cashmere Argyle sweater, I get a whole different
one
kind
without
of
sleeves, though. It's a thing.
I wear my penny loafers.
Yeah.
And my Argyle sweater, I get a totally different girl. She still eats my ass, though.
And so your Argyle out. Jacket.
Made out of mink.
It is fur, but whatever. But what does that matter? I mean, yeah, with Argyle fur coat.
No. I mean,
but I mean, it's interesting. But I wanted to just say just to not engage, even with you, not catching the fact that she was insecure and so on and so forth. But I mean, this is something that you're implementing these things and you'll get better at it.
Right,
but not engaging and then going, listen, I'm not happy with this, and I'm not happy with the way we're responding, and being calm and being unaffected by it, and then going, look, you gotta, you know, go to Wendy's because I'm not gonna do this. I'm not gonna reward this behavior. I think it's important to say that. Now to also say you need to, the next step is to stop it before it gets to the point where she's freaking out and she'll say, what about the numbers? You know, it's to stop that. It's like I get guys will say, oh, you ever have a girl slap you in the face? I've never had a girl slap me in the face.
No,
it just.
Such a sister.
No.
You don't. That's not the frame.
Yeah,
you want to be the grounded guy. Why would you like
touch that? Or you know what I mean? The framing of that. The framing. Like, what you meant by
like,
that?
Kind of like whenever you meet somebody, whoever it is, with any person out there, you have a different frame.
Right.
You have a different frame of your grandma than you have with Mara,
sure.
Or your dog, or anybody you interact with.
My frame with Mara is the same as my grandma.
Or your grandma.
I'd be like, "What's up, bitch?"
So when you meet somebody, you establish that frame from the very beginning.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So if you're in the beginning, like trying to overcompensate, make her happy no matter what, and you always like go out of your way, then that's the frame. And then if you break that, then she's like, that's not who you are.
Right.
So it's very important to not mess it up in the very beginning. And how do you do that? Is being secure in who you are, acting the way you want to be perceived, and getting to that point through meditation, working on yourself, reading the right books, being around the right people.
Right.
I guess people that are around you, they also like see, oh shit, look, this guy is doing amazing. The way he's behaving attracts other people to him. So if I start maybe adapting some of his like behavior, then I get the same results.
Right.
You know, you become who you hang out with.
Right. Sure.
And the actual thing that I like the most, instead of like, oh, you're the average of the five people you hang out with the most, is more like you are the direct reflection of the expectations of your peer group.
Sure.
Some like American Marshall said that once, that whatever people expect of you, that's what you'll do.
Sure.
If they expect you to be the best, you'll act to your fullest potential.
And I think the other thing is something
to be like some pushover, you're more inclined to actually act that way.
I also think that the other thing is I forget which book this, but making a declarative statement about who you are, creates the destination, because your brain doesn't want you to be a liar. So when you say, I am this,
you want to be consistent. You want to be congruent.
Right. And if you're not congruent, then your brain goes into overload, like, what the fuck is going on? We have some listeners. Yeah. Yes.
All right. Tweets.
So we're going to help some people today.
Let's do it.
I'm a 21-year-old college student, started hooking up with this cute white girl in the spring at my school. She made me work for it first, had to take her out like three, four times. before she gave up.
Yeah, I did. I do think we did that one.
We
that
did
one.
This one?
Yeah, oh. You might have not been here for that one.
Oh, sorry.
That's all right.
Okay, so then I'll go to the tweets.
Yes,
our,
please.
Our Twitter at Beige Phillip. We did receive some tweets. Is marriage really worth it?
What do you
marriage
think about that?
Wow.
Huh?
That's a good question.
Have you been married?
To be the closest I got to that is like a 3-year relationship.
Okay, so no.
So, but
although ironically that did outlast both of Mara's marriages together. by a full year and a half, I do believe.
The first question you need to answer there before you even go into like should you marry somebody or not is, do you actually want to be with one person for the rest of your life? Is monogamy the right thing to do? I think in our age, monogamy doesn't make as much sense anymore. It's more cosmopolitan. Everyone's meeting each other. And you can love multiple people at the same time. Usually, when you're not doing that, it's just because you're afraid that you can't get somebody
else. You
don't
feel like you have options.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Just lock somebody down. It's like, I love this person. I marry him. And boom, lock down. One thing I would say, though, is when you decide to have a child, that's
responsibility.
That's when the child needs one consistent masculine energy and one consistent feminine energy.
Right.
If you want to make sure that it has the best upbringing. So in that sense, it makes sense to be monogamous. If you marry or not, doesn't really matter.
Right.
Marrying is just something that I think the way it's being done, it's outdated because it is much more about how do you feel about each other. And the marriage, just it should be for you. It shouldn't be a show off.
Right.
Because most people, they get into a relationship, then they're together, and then after 5 years, it's kind of okay, and they want to spike it up. You're like,
a lot of people get married because it is the course of things that you should do. It's society, like you did high school,
you did university, you got your job, you got your promotion, and now you should marry.
There's an amazing
also differences between suburban and urban areas. And you're looking at, I mean, United States specifically, Middle America, the success rate for marriage is much greater than.
It's also a matter of options. It's also about a matter of options. It's also a matter of socialization,
lifestyle
and stuff,
as well,
and lifestyle. Look, I mean, if you're a Mormon, you can have multiple wives, and you don't really have to sell a threesome. So, you know, because it's part
of. Everyone in my family has been successfully married and happy, other than me.
Right. Well, I would say this as well. I mean, I just saw this documentary called Marriage Corp, which talks about the rate of divorce and people getting married and how they get divorced and how the legal, at least in this country, the legal aspect, the way they milk both sides of the marriage simply as a way to, because family law has become a whole nother business in itself, divorce. Yeah. and people divorcing and basically they give you one of the things is when you go through divorce is the first thing you do is you have to give a breakdown of what your finances are, how much money you have, the real estate, the property, whatever.
Yeah, I've done it a couple of times.
Right. Yeah. And here's what's interesting about that. That is how the lawyers, both sides of the lawyers, size you up in terms of how much money they're trying to get from you. They know what money you have and then they milk you to go through this. The days of just, okay, this didn't work out, let's get a divorce, it's just not the case anymore.
Yeah, but also since 1996, the rate of divorce is actually declining.
Yeah, but it's still a scam.
Also, wait. That's also, though, because less people are getting married.
No, it's because people are getting married later in life. The average age of marriage is 27 for a male now and 24 for a female. Back in 96, it was much younger. And so the rate of marriage is still equal. I just read that this study.
Okay.
And they
if somebody asked that question, I would go on Netflix and check out this documentary called Marriage Corp. I would say, no, it's not worth it. I mean, I just would. I mean, I hate the way, because it's a way in which
for yourself, you don't think it's worth it. I feel like it's an individual choice.
I think, because
if you really think about it, right? As Valentino was saying, the idea of like, if you want to take care of your kids, you should be monogamous,
right?
But not necessarily married. What is the benefit of marriage, really, other than contractually
It creates
there's
a business.
Some benefits for taxes.
You gotta check this. This documentary just fucked me up. I mean, even I there was a situation because I've been married and I kind of got out of it unscathed. You know, financially unscathed. Or, you know, I got a down payment on
it
a house.
Could have been a lot worse.
Yeah, it could have been
significantly worse.
But
yeah.
What you're talking about is tens of thousands of dollars that these two lawyers are going. Okay, this is what these people are worth. Now we're gonna milk them. And it's not even about the breakup. It doesn't even become they antagonize both parties so that they fight about so that they basically can steal your money.
Right.
And that is because of the institution of marriage. Now, if we're talking about monogamy, it's something totally different. But I mean, the minute you make that legal in this country, but, it becomes a way in which people can extort. The lawyers can extort.
Picture this internationally. That's what we think about it here. Internationally, the laws are much different.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, let's say you're in a place where financially getting married won't fuck you up if you get divorced. There's places where it's not
yeah,
the same.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, where it's not
so
as,
is it worth
as
it
a litigious. Well, I mean, this guy's asking here. He's from
I guess
here,
fair
so
enough.
So litigiously,
yeah.
Litigiously, I don't think that marriage is
there's really no benefit for you as a
it's
dude.
Not a benefit. Yeah. I don't even say it's a benefit. It's a harsh way in which litigiously lawyers steal your money. And not just your money as the guy, both
right,
parts.
But you're speaking about divorce.
Well, but the point is, you enter into this matrimony
with
hoping it's going to
work.
Right. What would be, from your expectation, Mark? What would you think would be the benefits of marriage?
Well, I would only get married if I were planning on having a family.
Right.
Right.
Was that the case the both times that you were married, or no?
Yeah, I thought I was going to have kids.
That was the intention.
Yeah.
Okay. And I would agree with that.
Okay.
I would agree with that as well. But I mean, even I would even now, after looking at this documentary called Marriage Corp. It's on Netflix. Check it out. I don't even think I would enter in a legal marriage with anybody because things happen. People fall out of love. Things change. And then you're
also dealing, I think, and this is especially true with women. We're generalizing. Fuck it. But when you're dealing with someone at their most emotional point, that's a dangerous thing, especially when the law is on their side of what goes on. Because going into a marriage, listen, everybody goes into it going, hey, this is fantastic. Sure. We're going to be together forever. Lollipops and rainbows and sunshine.
Puppies and ice cream.
And then when it's not going well, fuck this. I'm going to burn this house
and
to the ground.
And then what you find with this documentary is talking about is how the lawyers actually instigate that. Well, you could get more. And how could they instigate this kind
of... Because that's their business. Sure. They don't make money unless you fail.
And literally, this you don't... It's the only situation litigiously in this country where you're not provided legal counsel.
Mm.
You don't get a free...
There's
like
no public defender for that.
Yeah, there's no public defender for it. You got to pay.
You can hire their lawyer or represent yourself.
And if you try to represent yourself simply... And the lawyers and the judges are involved in this as well, as long as the assessment of your family. There's people that are family assessors. There's one guy was a family assessor, and he was like, look, if you want this to say what you wanted to say, it's going to cost you $25,000. And this dude was like an S&M gay S&M submissive on Facebook and like freak just and he was like, well, you're not a fit parent, you know. And so it brings in all these litigious things that it just shocked. I was like, I would never get married again. I was like, at least not in this country.
Yeah. Why would you? You know? It really doesn't make sense. You could still have children. You could still have a family. My brother did that. He's very happy.
Yeah.
You know, he's still a family guy. He's still the provider. But it's just a messy thing that you're setting yourself up for, and we've done it to ourselves in this country.
We got one more, and then Valentina's got to get out of here.
That's exactly true. Quick thing about marriage, I think if you really want to make sure that it's going to last, instead of going on a honeymoon after you got married, you should just lock yourself down into a room for 7 days with nothing but each other.
Mm.
And they should do that.
I do that every time I meet a girl on a weekend.
Well, that's a different thing.
It just doesn't work out. No
cage.
No belt. Nothing. Just you and her. Because
what is
or go on a holiday. Like going on a holiday where it's just you and her and pretty much nothing else that could like distract you will show you do I really want to spend the rest?
This is before the marriage, you're saying?
Before.
Well,
before
if you think, marriage, if you think about it, if you think about it, like there was a there used to be a reality show here called Temptation Island. They would take people and put them on a tropical island, and they would hang out and just talk in a hammock while they were drinking coconut water out of a coconut, and they were like, "Wow, I just love him." Sure, you love him.
In
that sense, you can evoke love in that situation.
Yeah, it's pretty easy to love whoever you're hanging out with. This is great.
I think that people should, after they get married or before they get married, they should work in a coal mine together.
Detroit.
Stay at a Motel 6 for like that.
Or even
vacation.
Go trekking. Travel to India. Where it's like, you guys got to make it happen together.
Go to India and then... Yeah.
Go to India, man.
Shit in a hole in the ground.
Yeah. You can still love that after you watch
eat that shitty-ass food.
In a hole.
With them onions. Be around the motherfuckers that don't use deodorant. Then you see if you got love. You got motherfuckers with no deodorant.
And if you can't afford that, just ride around in cabs in New York City.
Yeah, go to East New York.
It's really a stress test for the relationship.
Yeah. See if you, see if you love me, bitch. Do you love me?
Roll the windows up.
There's no air fresheners in here. Oh, man. Oh, wow. Valentino, thank you so much for coming out, bro. I really appreciate
you coming, dog.
I'd like you to, if you got anything going on that you would like to promote and anything, just let me know. Let these guys know, please, now.
I don't really want to promote anything. It's just like, all I wanted to do is give you certain insights, some basics here and there. And the thing is, we'll be in the U.S. until the end of the year.
Okay.
I'll be in Chicago next week, then a month in L.A. where we have the Project L.A., and then we go Vegas and Miami. If you just want to get some more tips about this, a couple more insights, you can go to my YouTube. It's Valentino Cohen with K-O-H-E-N.
We'll tweet you out and stuff. We'll tweet you stuff once the episode is up. So.
Check that out. There I go.
What about the website? You got a website as well?
Yeah, also valentinocohen.com.
Okay.
Best thing, just get the free YouTube videos. Get it going. Get yourself immersed in this.
Yeah.
If you actually want to change it.
Yeah.
Because if it's just like one little thing that you pay attention to, it's like, oh, Twitter, oh, Instagram, oh, yeah. I have to watch... Kim Kardashian's ass, and now I just gotta watch YouTube videos for Valentino.
Right.
If you really wanna like get the most out of it, you always wanna focus on one thing for a certain amount of time and then get it handled. That's it.
I like this dude, Beige Phillip fans. I like this dude. Check him out. Danny, talk to me.
You can catch me on Puff Carter 718 at Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. So that's what I'm doing right now.
All
right,
do it. Mara, talk to me, baby.
You can always find me through my website, maralive.com, or through our website, beigephillip.com. All the links are there. Hit us up on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook.
Harry, talk to me.
All my stuff is available at my website, ihatecomedy.com. And you could go to my Instagram, Twitter, YouTube. It's all the same, at Harry Turjanian.
Andre?
Yo, follow me on Instagram and Twitter, Andre_D. Thompson.
Okay, and y'all can find me everything at Dante Nero, Instagram, Dante Nero Comedian. GYBB, get your balls back, BABB, be a better bitch, WWDD. What would Dante do? If y'all want a one-on-one consultation, hit me at SaveMeDante@gmail.com. I'll talk to you on the phone if you need me. The sexual revolution is being podcasted. Hashtag learn, bitches, learn. I love y'all, man. Don't forget to rate and review us on iTunes. You know you can get us on that. I love y'all. Get at me. Peace.